little bit about astrology in the New Testament. And let's look at some interesting things. I think the most fascinating thing to me is the prophecy that is contained within the New Testament that comes through the words of Jesus Christ. And you'll find it on page 859 of the Bible, which to me, if indeed we're right, and this is an astrological prophecy, as opposed to some kind of a biblical prophecy, then the implications of it are tremendous because they deal with us today. And then the prophecy is fulfilled at a specific time. Most times if you see prophecies in the Bible, the fulfillment of that prophecy is left up in the air, and people say, well, I think this is the time that it meant, or, you know, maybe it's going to happen soon or whatever. But this is on page 859 of those little Bibles you have. And this is a statement that Jesus Christ makes. And if we want to interpret this astrologically, because there are reasons I think that you should, but let's take a look at it. Luke chapter 22, Jesus is talking about where we may meet with him in order to take part in the Passover supper. And in Luke chapter 22:10, he says, behold, when you are entered into the city, there shall a man meet you bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he enters. Well, the man with the pitcher of water, if we want to speak about this astrologically, is none other than Aquarius. And when we understand that we are living in the Aquarian age, do we fulfill the prophecy then of Jesus Christ by following the sign of Aquarius, entering into the house, which is ourselves, going to the large upper room, which would be the right hemisphere of the brain, and there encountering that which is Christ consciousness? It's a magnificent thought of a prophecy being fulfilled. Now, if we want to literalize the Bible, which I don't do, I think you'd have a difficult time with this because of the fact that by literalizing such a statement of the man carrying the pitcher of water, you'd find out that a man wouldn't be caught dead in those days carrying a pitcher of water. So there, I believe, is a direct prophecy of the times that we're living in now, which is the age of Aquarius. When you see the man with the pitcher of water, follow him into the house. And when ye ask, where is the guest chamber, he shall show you a large upper room furnished there, make ready. Now remember, Jesus Christ said, to those of you who are within, these things are given to know the mysteries. To those who are without, all these things are done in parables. So in this symbolic language, it's a very interesting thing to say, there's an astrological evidence in the Bible of the man with the pitcher of water, the Aquarian age. Somebody can say to you, well, I don't think you're interpreting this properly. Fine. That's open to discussion. But don't tell me it's not in the Bible, because it is. And this indeed is the age of the man with the pitcher of water. And the things that are happening in the world today are absolutely astounding. We talked this morning for just a moment, and since this is a different tape and it wasn't, we were talking about the question of this gays in the military business. And Albert, it has nothing to do with gays in the military. It has to do with Uranus turning traditions upside down and shaking them to the foundation. And that's what's happening. That's what's happening. And it's just the beginning of the change. So indeed, the Aquarian age is heralded by the planet Uranus, and indeed Jesus Christ talks about looking for the man with a pitcher of water. Let me show you some evidence that I think is very interesting of astrology in the Bible, and evidence that I think you can see without too much difficulty. If you were to look at the stars and you were to look at the Bible, you'll see something very interesting. If you look at the constellation Ursa Major, which is the big bear, okay? Oh, I can't draw a bear, but that'll have to suffice, okay? Ursa Major, the big bear, okay? In the right rear leg of the bear is a star that is called the Daughter of the Assembly. All right? That's interesting. That's in the right rear leg of the constellation Ursa Major is a star called the Daughter of the Assembly. In the right front leg of the constellation Ursa Major is a star called Talitha. Now, knowing that is an astrological and astronomical, if I should say, fact, then let's go to the Bible and see something really, really interesting, which then leaves you wondering, not only did Jesus talk about the age of Aquarius, but you wonder now, just what is the Bible telling you? Because where do these stories come from? Let's take a look at something. Knowing that the Daughters of the Assembly is one part of the constellation Ursa Major, and Talitha is the other part of the constellation, go to page 814 in those little Bibles of yours and look at something that I think you'll find interesting. It's in Mark chapter 5, okay? And the reason that I point this up to you when we discuss astrology in the Bible is because I'm bringing to you to the point of thinking, where in God's name did these stories come from? And, you know, are the stories written by divine inspiration per se, to show the way of a religious angle, or are they actually taken from the stars in their course, which I think maybe we have a little evidence that we'd say that's the point. Let's look at Mark chapter 5, and let's go to verse 22. And it says, "And behold, there comes one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and when he saw him," meaning Jesus, "he fell at his feet." Here is a ruler of the synagogue, and the synagogue in those days was also known as the assembly. Okay, so we have the beginning of the story. Here is a ruler of the assembly by the name of Jairus. And what does he say? "And he besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lies at the point of death." Interesting. Now we have the daughter of the assembly. We have the ruler of the assembly, Jairus, and we have his daughter. So now we have covered the right rear leg in this constellation Ursa Major. Now this is the interesting point. Zip over, if you would, to Mark chapter 5, where you are. Go to verse 41. Jesus enters into the house of this little girl. And he says, "And he took the damsel by the hand, and he said to her, Talitha, human, Talitha, rise." You know, it's too much to say, oh, well, that just happened to be a coincidence. There's no coincidence at all. It's astrological. There is something of astrological significance contained within the story that we just read. The daughter of the assembly is the right rear leg. Talitha is the right front leg. Here comes Jairus, who is the leader of the assembly, saying his daughter is dying, and her name just happens to be Talitha. So that's interesting. What do you make of it? Make whatever you want of it. I'm saying to you that there was a connection between the Bible and astrology. There's a connection between the Bible and astronomy. There's a connection between the Bible and the stars. Of course, if we were to look, and I think it's always good when you're talking about astrology and you're talking about its influence in the Bible, one of the things you should always lead off and do is open the first page of the Bible, because many times people who dabble in astrology for whatever purposes are set upon by fundamental religionists and saying this is evil, you shouldn't do that. And to me, when I stand up in this particular gathering place, I like to look at the Bible and be able to provide you confirmation that the Bible either says you should or you shouldn't, because we're Western-oriented people, and I think simply to say, well, you know, it's okay, does not run with a lot of people. It's important for me to say, here's the Bible, here's what you treat as the Word of God, what does it say? So when we talk about astrology, per se, from a scientific basis, I'm not talking about Madame Lulu at the boardwalk, I'm talking about scientific astrology. What does it say? On the very first page of the Bible, Genesis 1, okay, you open Genesis 1, and you go to verse 13, and it says, God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens, these are the stars, to divide the day from the night, and he says, let them be for signs. Signs. So first of all, the Bible is confirming the fact that the creation of the stars, among other things, has a purpose for signs. So if a fundamentalist comes up to you and says to you, you shouldn't dabble in that, you should say, well, it says on the first page of the Bible that the stars are for signs, and if the stars are for signs, don't you think is a responsibility on our part to find out what the signs mean? Okay? Now, there's another thing that I think is interesting, too. And you see the stars, and they're Capricorn, and all of these various things, whatever. If you open up to the book of Psalms, and you look at Psalm... Oh, gee, I haven't done this before. I wasn't planning on doing this in this particular thing we're doing tonight. But if you look at Psalm, I hope this is where it is, 147th, okay? It says in Psalm 147, and which is, I don't know what page it's on. Would somebody tell me what page Psalm 147 is on in those little blue Bibles?
539.
Page 539, okay? Now, we've just found one thing. What the stars should be for signs. God said the stars are for signs. And so then it is not only something you should look at, you should have a responsibility to see what these signs are. Okay? So that gives you the authority to look astrologically at these things as signs. Now, there's another point here when you look at the stars and their names. Look at Psalm 147 and look at verse 4. And what does it say? He tells the number of the stars and he calls them all by their names. That's interesting, isn't it? So now we've got two things that's going for the scientific astrologer. Number one, the Bible says the stars are for signs. And number two, the Bible says that God has named these. So I would say, if God says they're for signs, I should find out what the signs are. And if God has named them, I should find out why he has chosen to call them what he has. Okay? There's two instances. Now, one of the things that the astrologer does, the scientific astrologer, would to show the influence that stars have on the lives of people. Okay, so right now we don't know whether we can go along with that, because after all, we are Christians and in the Word of God and the house of the Lord and all of that kind of stuff. We don't know if we can go along and say, well, can we show in the Bible that the stars influence people in one way or the other? And the point and the fact is, yes, we can. Let's look at the book of Job. Somebody will have to tell me what page it's on in those little Bibles, but I want you to find Job chapter 38, okay? And somebody will yell out what page that's on in the little, excuse me?
458,
okay. 458, 459, that's fine, okay. That's great. Job chapter 38. And I want you to see something. And in Job chapter 38, I want you to go to verse 31. Now, the Pleiades is a star constellation, is a constellation of a cluster of stars in the constellation Taurus, okay? And this is what it says. Job chapter 38, verse 31. Can you bind the sweet influences of Pleiades? There's the Bible saying that this Pleiades has a sweet influence somewhere, somehow, on the affairs of men and women. Can you bind it? Can you stop it? Sorry. And then in addition to that, it says, can you loose the bands of Orion or Orion? There's two constellations. There's a star cluster of Pleiades. There's a constellation Orion. And it talks about influences. Now, look at verse 32. It's very interesting. Can you bring forth Maseroth? That's an interesting word. You ought to go home. When you get home, look it up. Maseroth. Do you know what it means? It means the 12 signs of the zodiac. That's what the word Maseroth means. Doesn't mean anything supernatural. It means the 12 signs of the zodiac. And it says, can you bring forth Maseroth in the seas? Can you guide Arcturus? Arcturus is a star in the knee of some big constellation. Man, I forget what it is, but Arcturus. So anyhow, there we have something that we can look at and go into the study with, saying, number one, the Bible says the stars are for signs. Number two, the Bible says God names the stars. And number three, the Bible says that they influence you. Okay? So that's interesting. And I think, to me, that sets a foundation for us then to go ahead and take a look at this and say, hey, we have some authority to do it. I wouldn't do it otherwise. What is astrology in the New Testament? Astrology in the New Testament is born basically of this. When you have the movement, if you would, of the solar system, you have the sun which travels through the universe and comes upon the constellation Crux, which is the cross. On December the 21st, the sun crosses Crux the cross. It's on the cross. It's crucified. On December the 22nd, 23rd, and 24th, it's the winter solstice. The sun is entombed in the bowels of the earth 3 days and three nights. Now, Jesus is crucified and then entombed 3 days and three nights. Now, the beautiful part here is on December the 25th, which we call Christmas Day, the end of the winter solstice, and God's Son is born. It comes out of the solstice, it comes out of the entombment of the bowels of the earth, and it begins its upward movement where it will impact at Aries, which is the Lamb of God, which takes away the cold of the winter. It becomes the burnt offering. One of the interesting things is very astrological. There is astrology in every part of the Bible. One of the very interesting things of astrology in the Bible is that if you read through the Bible, you'll see the Old Testament is filled with admonitions about burnt offerings. You should always take an animal and burn it up. See, and that'll be a sweet-smelling to God, and after that, everything will be okay. Well, the reason that is because the sun, which is the fire in the heavens, comes up to Aries, which is the lamb or the ram of God, and the sun consumes the lamb. The sun consumes the ram. That's the burnt offering. Then the sun moves to the eastern sky in the northern hemisphere, and summer comes. So, in other words, summer cannot come until there's been the burnt offering. Summer cannot come until the fire of the sun has consumed the ram. Do you see that? In the coldest depths of winter, as we sit now, we know that something has to happen. The sun must make the Aries. The fire must consume the lamb before there can be summer. Before everything can be born again, brand new, there must be the burnt offering. So that's the purpose of it in the Bible. In other words, the purpose of burnt offerings in the Old Testament is astrology. And that's something to think about because it's a fact. And that's the only reason. Tell me, if you can, a reason why some god in some far-off distant place would say, what really psychs me up is when people fry, chopped liver or whatever the heck. What would be the purpose of it? There's a great purpose of it because what is being said is that the fire must consume the ram, the sun must intersect Aries so that the summer can come. Now, so what, you'd say? What's the purpose of that? Because as it is in the universe, so it is in here. And the fire, which is the passions that rise from, where is this? The solar plexus. Through the meditation, impacts on the pineal gland, which is Aries, and then opens the right hemisphere of the brain. So the right hemisphere of the brain is not going to open, and new life cannot come to you unless what happens? The burnt offering. The fire that comes from the solar plexus must rise through meditation via the kundalini and impact on the pineal gland of the brain, which is Aries. So that basically sets the basis as we talk of astrology. But I think we've accomplished a lot in a few minutes, haven't we? We've gotten authority from the Bible to say, hey, these are signs. We've gotten authority from the Bible to say God named these things. We've gotten authority from the Bible to say that they have influences on you. And we now have seen that the life of Jesus Christ curiously matches the movement of the spheres of the heavens, the sun, in its course. If you look astrologically for those people who work in astrology, and you look at symbols, the symbol, the astrological symbol of the earth is a circle with a cross. Okay, that's the astrological symbol of the earth, a circle with a cross in the center. The long part here from top to bottom represents the winter and summer solstice. And the part here is from west to east, representing the equator, where, the spring and the fall equinox, when the days and nights move into equal length. That's the sign. And interesting, if you take the earth and put the cross on it, that's a symbol of Christianity. No, it's an astrological symbol of the earth. That's how the earth is represented in astrology, a circle with a cross in the center of it. It's always been that way. And so you have the summer and the winter solstice, and you have the spring and the fall equinox going this way, and the summer and winter solstice going from north to south. And so, see, this is what happens, as I showed you a moment ago, when the sun impacts on crux, which is the cross. The sun is crucified on this cross. So the sun is literally crucified on this cross, and then moves up onward to the summer solstice, where the days begin to shorten. See, right now, in the depths of winter, the days are beginning to lengthen. When we get to the summer solstice as the peak of summer, when everything is blossoming, and suddenly the days begin to shorten. In fact, you get to June 21st. Once you move beyond June 21st, the earth starts to grab back, and the sun retreats. It's interesting. Now, let's take a look at some things. I'm not telling you to believe anything. I never have told you to believe anything. I'm just throwing stuff out. And if you find it interesting, you can go research it. You can find books on astrology or whatever you want to do. But there's an interesting thing. John the Baptist, in the Bible, John actually represents the earth. Okay? John the Baptist represents the earth. Jesus
represents the sun. That's what they are.
Don't even know if these two people ever existed. That could get me in a lot of trouble every place else but here. Right. And it's not necessary that they ever did exist, because the principle exists. That's what's important. The principle exists. John the Baptist represents the earth. Jesus the Christ represents the sun. And John is born 6 months before the sun god. And there's something that's very interesting. Because as we begin our movement, as the days lengthen, the Baptist or John or the earth says something that's very, very critical to the survival and to the rebirth of the earth. And I want to show it to you on page 866 of your Bible. And I want you to look at it astrologically, not as a man speaking, but as the earth speaking, okay? The earth speaking about the sun during the winter. This is the dark time, see? And what must happen in order for the sun to mount itself upward and for new life to come and for the leaves to return to the trees, etc., etc., etc. If we look at John chapter 3 on page 866, and if we look at verse 30, John the Baptist makes a very, very interesting statement that I think represents the statement of the earth concerning the sun. John chapter 3, verse 30, he says, "He," talking about the sun or Jesus, "must increase, but I must decrease." You see? He must increase, but I must decrease. And that will occur. That's what's happening right now. The power of the earth is decreasing because on December the 25th, the sun was born. Do you get it? So the power of the sun is increasing, and the power of the earth is decreasing, and that will go on up until June 21st when the earth will start to take back from the sun. See? That's interesting. And you know, I believe it. See, the sun increases until the 21st day of June, when it moves to the fall equinox. And there, at that point, he has passed three quarters of his cross. He has his cross on his back, and he is moving finally to the crucifixion of December the 21st. Now, I would lay this out for you, too, as a point of interest that you might jot down in your notes and may think about as you dabble, and you may find things, because I only know a little bit. And I only bring this to you in 35 or 40 minutes or whatever. And there's a million of hours, and millions of hours you could spend on these things, millions of books that you could look at. But I offer this to you as an interesting point that the two thieves crucified with Jesus Christ are October and November, which are the only months in the year in which there really is no harvest of any consequence, the two thieves. And you might want to think that. And that's a theory of philosophy that's bought by a lot of people, you know, that we're talking about the entire thing, the crucifixion. Look, folks, listen to me. That sounds a little strange, what I just said to you, but remember now that the crucifixion that you read about in the Bible also takes place in the sky when the sun enters the cross, okay? And then right after that, the next day, the sun goes into hiding for 3 days and three nights in the bowels of the earth, and it is born on December the 25th. So are we talking about an entire astrological type of thing and not anything to do with human beings? Very well possibly may be, and I take some solace or consolation from the Gospel of Thomas, the book of Thomas, in which John is portrayed looking at the crucifixion and saying what an ugly thing it is, which it would be a hard, you know, if the only way some God can save us is by ripping and torturing people to death, then, you know, the whole thing is a mess. But then John goes up into a cave to get away from the sight of the crucifixion and sees Jesus standing there, and they both have a good laugh. And then John comes down, and everybody's weeping at the cross, and John said, "And I laughed, and I went away laughing, because I realized that God did all of this symbolically for the salvation of man." You want to read about that. It's in Joseph Campbell's book of Occidental Mythology. In the event that you cannot find the Gospel of Thomas in the lost books of the Bible, it's in Joseph Campbell's book of Occidental Mythology. Can you imagine this is John. We're talking about John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. This isn't John, you know, from the New Age bookstore. This is John saying the whole thing was a symbolic thing. Certainly it's symbolic. I mean, come on. We're talking about the influences of the stars on the earth and the movement of the planets and so forth and so on, and they are set up in an allegorical story about crucifixion and entombment and resurrection, because that's what must happen. And the son must be crucified on December the 21st, sit in the tomb December the 22nd, 23rd, and 24th, and be born again on December the 25th. Why? Because so must we. The five senses must be crucified in meditation, sit into the tomb, which will then force the resurrection as the energy drives itself upward for the new birth. Up into to Aries, the whole thing duplicates itself within us if life is to be fulfilled. And that's the beautiful part about it. Now, I mean, I have often wondered, I said, for God's sake, the most beautiful story in the Bible probably is the nativity of Jesus Christ, and though it duplicates the nativity of Hare Krishna, you know, I thought, well, that's nice because it means, you know, it's got some semblance of order from the beginning through Jesus, and that's fine. But I often wondered, of all the people that the Bible or God or whomever you want to call it selected to herald Jesus as king, the Magi. The Magi. The root of the word magic is Magi. Magicians. The wise men. There is no place you can go in ancient literature from the East where you read the word wise men that does not mean astrologers. Anytime in looking at the words of wise men in mysticism or the mystical words of the ancient East, they're talking about astrologers. And here, you have them coming from Iran, Persia, the wise men, coming from the East, the Magi, the astrologers. And again, what do astrologers do? They chart the movement of the stars. They chart, what are the stars saying? The Bible is telling you. That is the astrologers. In other words, the Bible is saying, certainly the whole thing is a cosmic event. Don't you see? The whole thing is a cosmic event which was mapped out by astrologers. And they wouldn't have introduced them in the story. Right. What does it mean? It means that when the Christ is born of the virgin consciousness, coming from the East, which is the right side, will be the wise men, the wise mind, wisdom. Enlightenment, understanding. But you could have made it anyway in the story if you wanted to just involve religious people. You could have done that. But no, the Bible involves astrologers. The one thing that Christians, fundamentalists, cannot deal with are astrologers. And here they come prancing down the highway with their little gifts and their charts and their signs, and I guess they gave Mary a reading and the whole bit, you know, and whatever. Which is fine. But that's what it is. There's no way you can get around it. Nobody can get around that because that's what the Magi are. And incidentally, if you ever dabble into the works of Zoroaster, which I love to do, Zoroaster was the chief priest of the tribe of Magi from Iran. And if you're into music, you're into classical music, you can also find a classical piece by Richard Strauss called Also Spake Zarathustra, which is Zoroaster. A remarkable, mysterious person, Zoroaster, from Iran, our mortal enemy, you know. For what reason, I don't know. But you know what they knew? Let me tell you. Why was Jesus born in a stable? Well, astrologer could tell you. He was born between the horse and the goat, between Sagittarius and Capricorn. Well, where does the horse and the goat hang out? In the stable. You got it. It's astrology. It's astrology. And so there we know. The birth would have to be in a stable. Because the birth occurs between Sagittarius and Capricorn, between the horse and the goat. So don't you see, it's a symbolic story. How, is this something, I mean, you know the amazing part of it is how the divine principle of writing allegory and symbolic story does it as such finesse. Who would ever think, and you stumble on this. I know why it's born in a stable, because there are animals in the stable. And the animals are the horse and the goat. So the birth is at that time of year. See? Because that's when the sun is born. So as the sun is born outside in the universe, the sun must be born inside in the inner universe, which is the solar plexus, or the place of the sun. And under the influences of the same thing, under the astrological influences. Now, let's continue the drama.
of the star. You know, in the story of Hare Krishna's birth, it just says that the stars were very auspicious. The star that always is found in the east and continues this astrological drama is Venus, goddess of love. But in ancient times, Venus had another name. Lucifer, the light bearer. That's pretty interesting stuff, isn't it? I mean, it really is. Isn't it a lot more fun to get involved and find out what the heck this is and just sit and go to church and say silent night and then go home and open a bottle of booze under the tree somewhere? Well, Lucifer means light bearer. And of course, being a star, it is represented very symbolically. Now here I go again, making a star. It's going to be terrible. Anyhow, it has 5 points and represents the 5 senses: sight, taste, touch, smell, and hearing. There's a very interesting way that the Eastern people write, and to emphasize in mysticism and things of the spirit, they would not only go after the astrological, go after the number numerically, as the numerical significance of the number 5, but they'll repeat the thing 5 times. Say, they'll repeat the thing the number of times. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Would somebody yell out, find the book of Isaiah, and tell me what page Isaiah chapter 14 is on in those little Bibles. I'm drifting off a little bit, but as I think of things that I think are interesting to you, I wanted to show you, because I see some people taking notes, and it's interesting, and I wanted to show you how you see this, okay? Isaiah chapter 14. Do you know, anybody find that? What page that's? 587, thank you. Okay, look at 587, and I'll show you what I'm talking about, okay? Now, first of all, let me show you something. Just hold your finger there. Don't go anywhere with that. But let me just show you something interesting, okay? In the fall, now listen to me. In the fall, the tip of the earth makes the star appear to change position, and this becomes the evening star. It seemingly crowds the sun back. This is Lucifer, okay? In the spring, the star appears to fall. In the spring and summer months, it appears to fall. Albert, you can map this out on your computer, astrological computer. But that's what happens. In the summer months, it's way up there, and it crowds out the sun itself. But then, in the spring and the spring and summer months, it appears to fall. But in the spring and summer months, it's called Venus. Okay? In the spring and summer months, it was called Venus, and in the fall, it's called Lucifer. But now, watch what happens. Just think of this. Just look at here for a minute. Here's the sun. Here's the star way up here. Lucifer, bright shining star. Okay? Then what happens? By the trajectory of the earth or whatever, it comes way down here. Now it's down here. Now watch the scripture here that I'm going to show you. You ready for this? And I'm going to show you astrology at its peak here in the Bible. Isaiah chapter 14, verse 12. Read it with me. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. See it? How you are fallen from heaven. Sure, it fell, see? All the way through you're being guided astrologically. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son in the morning, how you are cut down to the ground. Now, when you talk of fundamentalists, they'll say there was an angel who was messing around and God made him into the devil and, you know, he was cast down to earth. But this is talking astrologically. See? But now here's what I wanted to show you. Remember I told you about the 5 senses. Lucifer represents the 5 senses. Sight, taste, touch, smell, hearing. Let's go. Look at verse 13. For you have said, I will ascend into heaven. 1. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. 2. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. 3. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. 4. I will be like the Most High. 5. Okay. There's the coverage of the five senses, and that's, if you begin to study mysticism and the ways of the people who wrote mysticism and hid allegorically the words and symbolisms, you find out that's exactly what they did. They would repeat things 2, 3, 4 times. Okay? Or whatever the number they were trying to accomplish. So there's Lucifer and Venus, the morning star, you know, the star which is filled with love during the summer months, and the star which is cold during the winter months. Yes, sir?
Small item. Venus sets on west. Lucifer comes up on the east.
Okay. Interesting. Okay. Albert's got this super computerized astrology thing. I don't know how many of you ever heard of this name. But you see, before I get into that, to me, it's very interesting. When I read that Lucifer, as a star, is up high in the heavens in one time of the year and falls to the earth, and then I read, oh, how you are fallen, O Lucifer, bright morning star, then I know I'm speaking astrology. I'm talking astrologically. And then I should start pursuing this thing astrologically. Astrologers should, and many have done it. One of the premier persons that I've ever read as an astrologer who got into the significance of the Bible was a fellow by the name of Lyman Stowe. And Lyman Stowe wrote, back in the late 1800s, early 1900s. L-Y-M-A-N is his first name. S-T-O-W-E is his last name. And in spite of our traditions, Lyman Stowe was an astrologer who was very deeply involved in the Bible. And he said a couple of things. He says, let us consider history, that history points to 21 saviors and many Bibles. And he says, which is the right one? Or are they all allegories of the one and same God? And Lyman Stowe goes on to say, there are many religions. But which is the right one? And Lyman Stowe makes the next statement, astrology is the basis of every religion in the world. And it's interesting. And you may say, well, who the heck is Lyman Stowe? Okay. Who the heck is Lyman Stowe? But let me talk about somebody you do know and his comments about astrology. The guy that the doctors, I'm drawing a blank on his name, Hippocrates. Hippocrates was the founder of the Hippocratic Oath, which a doctor must take. Okay. His statement was, a doctor who does not have a total knowledge of astrology has no right to call himself a doctor. That's interesting. Because why? Because many people who are sick for reasons that are not necessarily earthly. They are subjected to things. And the average medical doctor has no knowledge of that. Oh, well. So Lucifer is reborn as the morning star of the east, or the west, whatever, Venus, the sun god. S-O-N is the sun god. So the sun is reborn every year on the 25th day of December. And we celebrate as Christmas. I still hear people say, do you believe Jesus was born on December 25th? You know, and here you're living in the midst of the universe, and all of the stars are changing positions and all of these things, and the Bible is really written in the stars. So the days begin to lengthen after December the 25th, and it's the winter solstice. And the sun, as we said, is born in a stable between the horse and the goat, between Sagittarius and Capricorn. And there's another interesting thing between astrological year. Astrologers use one day for a year. The Bible uses one day for a year, which is very significant also as to who is writing, you know, these things. There's a great communion between astrologers and the Bible as far as the way it's written. Now, let's look at a few things, and then we'll get out of here. But I hope it's been a little bit interesting so far. And as I said, I do not present myself as any astrologer or any, what happened? I don't present myself as any kind of an authority on this at all. I just have an ability to come up with stuff and share it with you. And, you know, you rip it apart and study it whatever way you think. But this is interesting. 30 years after Jesus was born, he was baptized. Let's look at that.
30 years after the birth of Jesus Christ, he's baptized.
30 days after the sun is born on December the 25th, it enters the sign of Aquarius, the water man.
What do you think? Huh? 30 years after his birth, Jesus enters the water. The water. 30 days after December the 25th, the sun enters the water man. Who is the water man? And what does the water man do? Oh, he takes the water and he puts it on the head of the candidate. And what is the water man doing with the pitcher of water? But that's not a coincidence. That's astrology in the Bible. It's astrology in the New Testament. Think of that. You remember that. Huh? 30 years after he's born, he enters the water. 30 days after December the 25th, the sun enters Aquarius, the sign of the water man. Now, we move on. Jesus Christ takes his disciples from among the fishermen when the sun enters the sign of Pisces, the fish. And everywhere that Jesus went, the fish was sure to go because everybody would draw a picture of a fish. It was the sign of Pisces. All over the place. That is one of the problems, that people are not versed in astrology, they're versed in religion, and so when they see things written in the Bible that say these are the end times, they're still saying these are the end times, but the people were saying these are the end times of Pisces. We are embarking into the new age of Aquarius. You're not in the end times of Aquarius, you just started it. You used to eat fish, remember? You had to eat fish on Friday. Eating fish on Friday was a continuation of the ancient honor of ritual of honoring the sun's passage into Pisces. And then, after Pisces, what has happened? Jesus is baptized in Aquarius. He selects the fishermen of Pisces. And now he enters Aries and becomes the Good Shepherd. The sun enters Aries, the Lamb of God. And the ancients used to look at Aries and say, Lamb or Ram of God, which takes away the cold of the winter, it's over. We're born again, the Lamb of God. See, and if you've been in churches, I've used to hit your chest and say, Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. You're talking astrology. It's Aries, the Lamb of God that takes away the cold of the winter. Because when the sun enters the Lamb of God, Aries, what happens? Spring. And then the sun enters Taurus, representing agriculture. The fields are fit for plowing. The sun god warms the earth for the harvest. And then sun enters Gemini. Gemini, the twins. Who are the twins of Gemini, the twin stars? Thank you, sir. A knowledgeable man. A knowledgeable man. Castor and Pollux. Should say that a little differently, but Castor and Pollux. They're the twin signs of Gemini. Do you know that? I was wondering if we could find out under which sign the Apostle Paul. Now, I mean, a lot of people say, I am under the sign of Cancer. I don't know what sign you're under. But I wonder what sign the Apostle Paul was under. Do you think we can find out? I think we can. Let's take a look at page 918 in your Bibles. And I will share something with you I find immensely interesting. And I thank the young man, and he's truly a young man, who shouted out Castor and Pollux as the signs of Gemini. But let's go to page 918, and we'll go to Acts, and we'll look at Acts chapter 28, okay? You got Acts chapter 28? I want to show you something that I think is immensely interesting. And if you'll look with me at verse 11, this is the Apostle Paul. And after 3 months, we departed in a ship of Alexandria, which had wintered in the isle, whose sign was Castor and Pollux. You see it? Gemini. I therefore hand to you the fact that inasmuch as ship in the Bible means human person, that this was saying that the Apostle Paul, ship or himself, was under the sign of Castor and Pollux. He was a Gemini. Oh, the reason, there was no reason for it to be in there. What the heck, they're going to tell you what sign the ship is, for God's sake. Pretty good, huh? I mean, they could say, well, you're interpreting it wrong, but that's a good one for the fundamentalists, isn't it? I mean, again, I really ripped that one out. And I'll bet you not one. And I would challenge you to walk into any of these fundamentalist churches and say, can you tell me a little bit about the Castor and Pollux? I'm into astrology. Well, that's evil. Then show them in the Bible. It's in the Bible. Castor and Pollux. Then something happens. The sun enters Cancer, the crab, and the vegetation begins to dry up and retreat, Albert. You know, we'll look out in my backyard and the crabgrass, when the crabgrass blooms again, you know, the crabgrass is all, but then something happens. As you get into that late part, it starts to burn up and wither away and everything starts to dry out, you know. And basically what is happening is the sun god is starting to really have its effect. The earth has backed away totally. He must, what? Increase. I must decrease. It's part of the sun's movement to what? The Lion of Judah, the King of Kings. So the earth begins to retreat. The sun grows stronger. And Jesus is the Lion of the 12 tribes of Judah. And the Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed. Look, it's interesting if you see. Here's the sun making its movement. The earth is withering under its tremendous heat. Don't you understand what you're seeing here? You and I, when we allow the sun to explode within us and rise in the meditation, suddenly the total power of it overwhelms us, and the carnal starts to retreat, and it starts to burn, and it starts to be put down, and we are starting to dwell in that which is the fire of the Spirit. The carnal mind is burned down, and the sun, and becomes that which is within us, the Christ, becomes the King, the Lion of Judah. Let me show you where that comes from. Record. Okay? Okay. All right. A little bit. Did I go that long? I guess I have. You don't seem bored, but I'm almost done. I wanted to share something. Look at Revelation chapter 5, verse 5, page 1005. Revelation 5 and verse 5. Verse 5. See? This is it. The sun has reached its zenith. It has entered Leo. In August. It has recovered from the cross, it has been entombed, it has risen, it has gone through the struggles, it has been baptized and so forth, and it has gone through the struggles of the earth and so forth and so on. And now it has reached the zenith, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. And this is what is being shown is okay in the sky, but it is also what happens within you as you enter into meditation. Revelation chapter 5 and verse 5. Weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed. That's Leo. Now, where this comes from, and I wouldn't be fair of me to do this without showing you this little thing, and I won't. I want you to go to page 115. I want you to go all the way back to the beginning of the Bible, to page 115, and let me show you something, okay? Here, when you talk about astrology, the tribes of Israel were set up in the Old Testament astrologically to the points of the compass, north, south, east, and west. This is where the tribe of Judah comes from. Watch this very carefully. Verse 3 of Numbers 2, and on the east side, towards the rising of the sun, shall they of the standard of the camp of Judah pitch. To the east side. When you look north, east is always at the right side. That's the tribe of Judah. Without getting you running through the whole thing, the tribe of Dan was positioned in the north, representing the emotions. The tribe of Reuben was positioned in the south, representing the physical. And the tribe of Ephraim was positioned in the west, representing the intellectual. Because what happens is the intellect, when it becomes overly involved in the things of the spirit, will move in and encroach on the sun and block the sun. So basically, if you were looking from a standpoint of astronomy or astrological sciences here, you would see that when the movement comes from the west, the sun cannot prevail against it. So if you start to intellectualize too much instead of spiritualizing, the west is going to encroach and the light's going to go out. Okay? That's what that's all about. And Dan was the emotions because he nipped at, like a spider nipping at the heels of the rider. Reuben was the physical because he had intercourse with his father's wife. And Ephraim was the intellect. And I don't quite remember why he was set up as the intellect, but he was. Okay. So there's a line of the tribe of Judah. There's something very interesting. This Judah is the tribe of light. If your eye be single, your body shall fill with light. Now, the interesting thing is, and I'm just coming up with it. The speed of light, and I can't remember exactly, but I'll show you how we can figure it out. All that were numbered in the camp of Judah, look at verse 9, were 100,000, okay, 80,000, that would be 80,000, okay, 100,000, 80,000, and 6,400. Okay? That is the constant speed of light, 186,400 miles per second. Tell me it's a coincidence. Okay? Pretty interesting. Isn't it interesting? I mean, it's there. So here, then, is the tribe of light. You will be filled with light. The Lion of Judah has prevailed. The sun is the light of the world. And the number of people counted as members of this particular tribe duplicate the constant speed of light of 186,400. Which I think is neat. See. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Just a minute. I have to do this so people can hear.
I'm pretty sure I'm correct on this, that the astrological symbol for the sun is a single dot, like a single eye.
Okay.
So that would be...
It would go right along with this. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, sir. All right. Let's just wrap this up. So the sun enters Leo, becomes the king. Okay. And the reason is because of the energy that enters when it assumes that position within you in your consciousness. And remember, all of this is wonderful for the earth. But you know what this is called in the universe? It's called macrocosm. But the same thing goes on in the universe inside of your body. It's called microcosm, but it's the same thing. And so then you should act out in the same way what happens here. And as you cast your energy to the right side, you become one of God's chosen. You become a Jew. That's the origin of the word Judah. Not a Jew who is born in a town, but one who camps at the right side is a Jew. As Paul says, a Jew is not one outwardly, a Jew is one inwardly. And right after Leo, what happens? The whole thing starts all over again. The sun enters Virgo, the virgin. See, astrologically, from a biblical standpoint, the thing begins from Virgo and winds up at Leo. The virgin consciousness gives birth to the Christ, and the whole drama acts itself out until you are fulfilled as the king, king of kings, the virgin consciousness. And then the sun enters Libra, which is the balance and the scales of justice. And we understand that after the birth of consciousness, it says, unto us a child is born, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, etc., etc. The sun enters Scorpio, which is Judas the betrayer, who sets the stage for the crucifixion on December the 21st. Between the two thieves, it all happens. See? And the cycle repeats itself. Born in the stable, the sun god begins his journey to the right hand of power. And so we have then for you to decide. But I think there's enough evidence, and I think that we've gone through it pretty good, to suggest that this Bible is an astrological book of great, great import, and that it admonishes you. Not only should you not stay away from it, it admonishes you to get involved in it. Don't get involved in it in fortune telling. Get involved in it scientifically, with the biblical principles that are here. Find out what the signs mean. Find out what their names mean. Find out how they influence your actions on this earth. And find out how you can overcome the activities of some of these influences, which can be negative, through your meditation. And then understand that as you follow the root of the sun within yourself, from the solar plexus to the pineal gland to the right side where Judah dwells, you become one of God's chosen people. You become a Jew who dwells with the inside, and then you become one who is with Christ. Thank you very much for...